Well, it's a real pleasure actually to give this talk here. This is a research that started more than 15 years ago when Dan Arbizu from the National, was at the time the director of the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, decided to come down to SFI and ask us to help them think out of the box and think about what the big problems they were facing were. Now, I have a suspicion this is in part because he's from New Mexico and he wants to see his relatives and stuff, but still, it's a very nice visit, very inspiring. And I realized during that visit that the key, what? You invited him? Good work. It influenced my my research. I realized at the time that the green energy, the key question around the green energy transition was technological progress. And could we anticipate which technologies would improve and which technologies would not improve? And that the whole question about what we should do about the green energy transition and how quickly we could execute it and how much it would cost depended on answering those questions. So we had a workshop the following year where we invited, you know, the leading people and many of the leaders in the field, including Bill Nordhaus, who has since received a Nobel Prize in economics for his work on this stuff. We were able to get him because he grew up in Albuquerque. And so he wanted to come see his family. And connections matter, geography matters. And Nordhaus at the time, I think at the time he was saying that the optimal transition, we should let the Earth heat up by about 4°C, because that would optimize our welfare. That would optimize our utility. He's now down to 3.1°. So he has gotten a little more reasonable, but I think he's still totally fucking crazy.
Fahrenheit or Celsius?
Yeah. So quite a bit more than the Paris Agreement. So anyway, I'm gonna say why I think he's wrong. In fact, why I think he got the sign wrong. It's not that his number is wrong, the sign is wrong. So here we go. So just to give an overview of what I'm gonna say in the talk, well, first of all, let me just background. Energy is about 75% of emissions. So we deal with energy, we've dealt with most of the problem. There's still agriculture and land use, cement, a few other things, but energy is most of it. And I'm gonna argue that we can not only make, we can make the green energy transition both very quickly, that is in the order of 20 years, and do so at a profit. I'm gonna present a simple example of how we could do it. It's not the optimal one, but it's one that is quite feasible. And I'm gonna discuss the roadblocks to making it happen. And if there's time, I might also discuss, this is an example of several sensitive intervention points. We had a piece in Science about this idea. In other words, places where you can make interventions that are extremely effective because you found a sensitive intervention point. Now, in a sense, the whole punchline of the talk is in this slide, which actually took us years to compile, and I don't think anybody else has done this comprehensively. So what you can see, we're tracking the evolution of the global energy landscape over about 140 years. And so here you can see, these are prices over here, costs or prices, and over here is deployment. So maybe to start with the deployment, that is how much energy is, are we, which source is providing our energy and how much is it providing us with? You see traditional biomass kind of dying out over here, and you see coal taking over and becoming dominant. You see oil and gas rising through time. You see hydropower rising up. Nuclear power comes shooting up and then levels off. And then, there's biopower, but then meanwhile, look at solar energy or wind or batteries or electrolyzers. Sorry, no, maybe these are batteries and this is electrolyzers. They're all coming up at very, very steep exponential rates. It's a logarithmic plot. Now, what are the prices of energy doing? Well, here you see oil. So this is oil for its primary use, like heating. Coal for primary use, gas, coal-fired electricity, which comes down and then goes back up again. That's unusual, but it changes course. Come back to that later. Nuclear electricity, which notice here, starts here in 1958 and goes up by about a factor of 3 in cost over time. In contrast, look at solar power, which started in 1958 with the Vanguard satellite and has come down by a factor of 5,000 since then. And what you can see is a fairly steady rate. Similarly, here's what we'll call P2X fuel, that is fuels made from solar energy or wind that are where you make hydrogen and then you make fuels based on the hydrogen. So you see something dramatically different happening with these renewable energy sources, unlike fossil fuels, which cost about the same now as they did a century ago. Once, you know, they bump up and down, but the trend is flat. Once you adjust for inflation, renewables have been dropping in price at rates around 10% per year, and deployment has been going up at rates around 30% per year, and that's been happening for many decades. So then the question is, where will this go in the future, and what does it imply about the green energy transition? Now, so Dan Arvizu's visit inspired me to really dig in to studying technology, and I was very lucky to have an unusual postdoc, Bela Naj, who some of you may remember. Bela was from Transylvania and, you know, ate all his meals at SFIT for free, right, because he believed that if you, you know, reduced your caloric intake, you could live longer. And but he was passionate about technology, and he rounded up a set of high school students and St. Johnny's to help him collect data on technologies so that we'd actually have some data to base our predictions on. And basically, I'd summarize what we discovered from this exercise this way. First of all, technologies improve at very different rates. These rates are highly persistent, meaning they are predictable. And even though the actual innovations are not predictable, the performance scores for classes of technologies are highly predictable. The most famous example would be Moore's Law, where in 1965, Gordon Moore predicted 7 years ahead, very quite accurately, what the transistor densities were going to be, and hence progress of computers. You only see these things with granular data. If you look at the kind of data that economists predict, you don't see these trends very clearly because they collected at much too aggregate a level. And so anyway, this is going to be the basis of the models I'm going to show you here. And just to give you a couple of examples of this persistence, here we see some consumer goods, and actually this is from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. So maybe I'll slightly correct what I said a moment ago, but most of our data doesn't come from these sources. But you see a real contrast between, on one hand, hospital services that go up over a 20-year period by 225%. College tuition and fees goes up by almost 200% versus televisions, which go down by 95%, meaning televisions over a span of 20 years, once you adjust for quality, are a factor of 20 cheaper than they were 20 years before. And so there's a huge diversity. What you can also see is this diversity is persistent. Televisions go down every year, college tuition goes up every year, et cetera.
This is corrected for inflation.
Pardon?
This is corrected for inflation.
I'm not sure if it's corrected for inflation. It doesn't matter because the point is the persistence. The inflation will shift it up or down a tiny bit. There was a lot of inflation in that period. Now, this is data that is not corrected for inflation. I know this because we made this slide ourselves. To Django and Francois Buffon made it. And so this is also taking data from the US manufacturing rates and of the prices of different products. And what you see is that most products are in this bell-shaped curve where most things live, where they don't make much progress. They kind of go up and down with inflation. And there's a little bit of dispersion, but not much. But then some products, in this case, all related to computers and electronics, go down by as much as 16% per year on average between 1958 and 2011. The point being that, and this is a characteristic shape, You have this bell-shaped curve that's got a very skewed tail for the outliers that are the rapidly improving technologies. Now, how can we take advantage of this and, you know, make use of empirical laws to forecast technology costs and hence understand the transition? Well, the method I'm going to make most use of here is Wright's law, which is kind of a cousin of Moore's law. Actually, it was postulated much earlier, 1936, by Theodore Paul Wright. It's a very interesting figure. He's the brother of Sewell Wright, who's one of the most famous evolutionary biologists, and Theodore Wright, who's one of the founders of political science. But he was the dark sheep of the family who went off to World War I, became a flying ace, came back, went into the aviation business, and in 1936 wrote this paper just observing that if you take a plane, this is actually not his slide, with no empirical data, he just wrote down the rule, that every time you double the production of a plane from a specific factory, that the cost of the plane to produce the plane would drop by about 20%. So it's a power law of this form with an exponent that's typically around 0.3. Although, I'll correct that statement. It's around 0.3 for technologies that improve at a fairly rapid rate. Most technologies, the exponent's around zero. Those are the ones that are living in the bell-shaped part of the curve. But for the technologies that are off on the left, it can be as high as maybe 0.3 or 0.4. Airplanes are an example of that. By the way, Theodore Wright was the head of airplane production during World War II and used his own law to correctly forecast what prices would do during World War II. And I'll come back and say about an exhaustive study we've done of this maybe in a moment.
Could you clarify something?
Sure.
It looked to me from what you said that this is learning by doing. But then you said this learning by doing holds in the places where there's rapid technical change.
Right.
And that's a quite different phenomenon, right?
Well, it holds in for technologies that improve. And so first of all, I don't call it learning by doing because it's not just learning by doing. It involves economies of scale and other things. It's all folded into there.
What's shown here is cumulative, not the current level.
It's cumulative, and it's true that we've done a lot of studies, and cumulative gives a much better prediction than the level. When the level goes down, then the cost roughly flattens out, although there can eventually be some forgetting. And the interesting thing is it holds not just at the level of individual factories, but at the level of whole technologies on a global scale. And that's a little puzzling because actually, if you try and aggregate things up, it doesn't aggregate up cleanly. So there are a lot of mysteries behind this. By the way, I learned about this here at SFI from Ken Arrow. I said, Ken, actually, I asked him a question. He misunderstood the question. So I asked him, Ken, I would like examples of empirical regularities that are predicted by economic theory. And what he said is, here's an empirical regularity. It's not really predicted by economic theory, but it's a good empirical regularity. And Ken wrote one of the papers trying to put some theory on this. It puts a little bit of theory on it, but it doesn't really explain why it's true. I think the best theory, and I don't claim it's a great one, was led in an effort led by James McNerney. I involved Sid Redner, who's sitting there, and Jessica Trangic as collaborators. And we were actually building on work by Stuart Kaufman and Jose Lobo, who were building in turn on work by John Muth, who, if you're an economist, you'll know actually is responsible for rational expectations. So very interesting. So Muth's idea was that engineers just throw darts at a dartboard, and all they are is smart enough to recognize when they've made a better throw and then move the cumulative score along. And he noted that you could get a power law, though only in the way he did it with an exponent of minus one. Stuart and Jose did a bunch of numerical experiments, and James and we actually came up with a theory, and we were able in the theory to also make another prediction, which is that more complex technologies should improve at a slower rate, because we defined something we call the design complexity. And by the way, that's now been empirically tested. It seems that it's roughly true, but it's pretty noisy. So it does depend on that, but there's only two papers and they're not as solid as I would like. These are just a couple of examples of Wright's law working. So we have transistors, photovoltaics, hard disk drives, and ethanol. You can see we're plotting total cumulative production in some units against average unit price. And so we're on a power law scale. And you can see that these are examples where it works quite well. By the way, you can do the same for Moore's law on this, and it works similarly well, which is one of the puzzles I'll mention in a bit. Now, so what we did, and this effort started with Bela and then went on for about a decade as we got better at figuring out the right way to do this, we tested for predictability through hindcasting. So we took the data that was collected, and here's the data set that Bela and the high school students collected, which they copied out of books, basically, or websites, or Bela wrote to Gordon Moore, and Gordon Moore sent him back his data on transistors and hard disks and all this data that he'd been personally collecting since 1965. And so you see those data sets here. You see a lot of chemical processes here, consumer goods up here like beer, milk, and energy, some energy things here. And so you can see some patterns that we roughly speaking, and actually this is now plotted on a semi-log scale. So this is a Moore's law type plot. You can see things are tending to come down exponentially. There's a dramatic heterogeneity in this. It's a very cherry-picked data set in that we just had to deal with whatever data we could find. Unlike the first, we have some other papers now where we're using more balanced data sets. That is where the data set, the data collection is systematic. So the data is not great, but there's 50 technologies here and enough to do what I'm suggesting on this slide. That is, we pretended to be at a given time in the past. We forecasted each possible future date year by year from that point in time. We repeated that for all past dates. And then we scored different methods based on their forecasting errors. And we pooled different technologies by assuming the improvement process was the same, but that different technologies had different parameters within the same universal process. And in the original paper with Baylor, we tested 7 different models. And we showed that Wright's law tied with Moore's law on that data set. And those beat everything else. And in particular, like Nordhaus has suggested a different way to do things where you combine Wright's law and Moore's law. That completely belly flopped. Why? Because there were too many parameters. So you overfit when you were doing it. And we also later on show that overfitting is by far the dominant source of error in this. 2 parameters is actually more than you really could fit, but you kind of stuck with 2 parameters. We also later on, we didn't do this with Bela, but later on, and let me just say, Bela's paper was really nice, and that involved me, Jessica Tranjic, and one of the St. John students, name I'm forgetting now. But we didn't have a systematic way to say how accurate the forecasts were gonna be. And so I really wanted that because forecasts without error bars are not really very useful because you quote a number, how good's a number? And so we wanted a better way to do it. So together with Francis Lafond, we reformulated things. So we actually rewrote Wright's law as a time series model. So in the way we're writing it here, these are the logarithm. This is the change in the logarithm of the price between year T and year T plus one. So the improvement in a given year is equal to the same Wright's law parameter here times the logarithm of the change in cumulative production from across the 2 years plus some parameter that gets the scale of how noisy the process is times a noise increment. And so we wrote this down, we played with different noise increments. We actually formulated a model
What is the time dependence?
Pardon? So time dependence is
implicitly in?
It's implicit here because each measurement has a time attached to it. And we're predicting the change in cost from the change in cumulative production. So if you really want to predict in time, you have to first predict the cumulative production that you'll have in the future and then predict that. And we actually, and with Bela, we did a lot of predictions in that flavor. We showed it works about the same whether you just use Moore's law directly as you assume an exponential process, which is very simple, like with drift, or whether you use this. And both predict the production and then predict the cost.
What is NFT in the right?
NFT here is just a noise increment.
I see.
Which we played around with in early versions. We assumed this, you know, technological change, it's got brakes. We must have to use something with heavy tails. But remarkably, we discovered we could just assume these were Gaussian increments, normal increments. And we got remarkably good predictions. I should say we did something else that you'll see on the next slide. We worked out for this kind of model, what errors do you expect? In other words, if the world really follows this model, then based on that noise, you can predict, you can predict the accuracy of your predictions, which are going to just depend on this parameter and this parameter. In fact, they just depend on this parameter. And so we did that.
Something about N of T,
We have to make an assumption, like we made an assumption that it's normal, an IID, okay? Later on, we show that that's not quite right. You actually need to put a little bit of correlation in there to get things right, to get the correct errors, but it's already pretty darn close to assume it's normal. So we worked out what the errors were gonna be, and then we did, you know, kind of, you can do standard statistical analysis, and you can rescale the errors based on I'm changing notation here. K is now the same as S in the previous slide because we actually first did it for Moore's law. 2 years later, we finally figured out how to do it for Wright's law, which is quite a bit more complicated. But we could show that if you normalize the errors based on the scale of the fluctuations, then you would get a T distribution, that is a student's distribution with N minus one degrees of freedom, assuming you actually had normal noise increments. And then you get a form, this factor A is, this tau is the time you are in the future. So the errors are growing both linearly in time, that's from the diffusive part, which is due to the fact that it's noisy, and quadratically in time, due to the fact that you're gonna make estimation errors with a finite data set. So here M is the number of data points that you have in the time series that you're using to estimate, to make your predictions with. Right? So assuming a Gaussian world, we could work all of this out perfectly. And we tested it up to time scales of 20 years ahead. And this actually shows that when you take these rescaled errors, this is data from different time scales, different data sets with different parameters. The whole thing collapses very well onto a T distribution as we predicted it should. Now, then, okay, this is an example of using that method to forecast solar PV. You can see the time series that we had is not even, it's not even all that long. This bump, you use that as part of the estimate to estimate how big the errors are going to be, because one of the things you see empirically is time series with lots of wiggles tend to have lots of wiggles in the future too. Time series that are really straight lines on semi-log tend to be much straighter and you get more accurate predictions. But so here we can see the one sigma errors, one and a half sigma, two sigma errors for a forecast of solar energy prices from 2016. I think the next slide, you can see it's an updated since then. We're still within the error bars we predicted. By the way, just for laughs, here's the Hinkley Point power plant, which is, you know, been on the books to be built in England forever, and that's, its cost is way, it's now well above current costs for solar energy, as we forecast it would be. For contrast, here's coal fuel price put in the same units. So you can see it just behaves utterly differently. Now, let's go to climate change. So
quick question.
Of course.
So on the previous slide.
Yeah.
So the new data points are kind of on one extreme side of the error predictions, right? Do you know why that is?
Well, so yeah. So what we do is we say, we don't know, we're not gonna try and understand, you know, what the Chinese are doing and what the Russians are doing and why the prices are going up and down for principles. We're just noting there's this trend. Now the trend is not perfect. So you can see for solar energy, if you made forecast here, it would have been on the other side of that. And so whether it's on this side or that side of the basic trend line depends on the particular era. And in fact, what happened is this bump was because materials got expensive for a while. There was a shortage of silicon, and solar PV depends a lot on the sort of castaways of chip manufacturer. Shit, might be my phone. Somebody turn it off. Just try and turn it off. It'll stop in a minute anyway. On the other hand, this is about when the Chinese started manufacturing stuff and prices plummeted because the Chinese were really boosting it and driving it down. So there's stories behind every technology that explain the wiggles. We're just explaining the broad trend. We're not even explaining it. We're just making use of it.
And
yeah.
So the coal and fuel stay flat.
So can you take your mask off?
Coal and fuel stay flat.
Yeah.
Is it for every resource that you mine that they stay flat, or is it that initially there's a decrease when you start mining it and then it
comes? Yeah, so this is a remarkable fact discovered by James McNerney that still has not been published because I've never been able to talk James into writing this up. But I think it's an amazing fact. James looked on the USGS website and he found there's 100 and something minerals on the USGS website. And they have prices over a century or more for almost all of them. And none of them vary by more than an order of magnitude over a century. They're all random walks. You fit, you know, random process models to them. Only a few of them have statistically significant drift, as you would expect when you're fitting 100 things. So basically, none of them improve in price except for one. That's industrial diamonds. But industrial diamonds are not mined out of the ground. They're manufactured. They improve by two orders of magnitude over 50 years. So it's just a striking fact that has no explanation. And you know, is a nice fact because it's one of the reasons why we're not going to destroy the planet, as I'll come to it in a minute. But it's a mystery. And because, let me just say a little bit more about it. On one hand, you have a Wright's law curve because oil extraction technology has improved dramatically over a century, but the resource has gotten more difficult to extract. And it seems as though those two things just cancel each other out. But why should you have 100 minerals that just cancel each other out and cancel each other out consistently over 100 years? You'd expect either U-shaped curves or arch-shaped curves, not flat curves. So there's something weird going on.
So in your framework, you're assuming, of course, for all these other technological things, it's continuous improvement. I mean, there's no asymptotic state.
We'll come back to this in a minute. This is called floor costs, central part of my story. I'll show you a slide in a little while. Okay, so climate change, you know, how long will it take for technologies to mitigate climate change? Is there a good investment strategies? Which technology should we support? How much will it cost? So we've been working on that for about a decade and now trying to incorporate this. And so just to update what I was just talking about, here are examples for what we think will likely be the four key technologies in the green energy transition. Solar, we've already been talking about. We're plotting this now versus experience in every case, rather than versus, that is, cumulative production. And we're showing the 95th percentiles of the prediction envelope in each case. And so back to Melanie's question, you can sort of see solar, sometimes it's on one side, sometimes it's on the other side, kind of like you'd expect. This is wind over here, similar plot, batteries. And so these are lithium batteries. And these are what we call P2X, that is power to something, electrolyzers. And where you can see the data is much crummier, and so the predictions aren't as good. But basically, the methodology works. These are plots that were updated quite a bit since we made our original explorations of the Bayline technologies. Now, by the way, I did make a prediction in 2010 about this with Makajani in a paper that was in the commentary part of Nature. And we predicted that solar photovoltaic prices would become cheaper than coal-fired electricity by 2020, and which at the time people viewed as a crazy prediction. The Economist, for example, in 2014 said solar power is by far the most expensive way to reduce carbon emissions. they were absolutely wrong. And in fact, if anything, we were a little too pessimistic. Now, this relates to Jeff's question, how has the mainstream done at this problem? Well, I already mentioned Nordhaus, who said that, it still says that the optimal amount of global warming is 3.1 degrees. So he has this little, you know, representative agent macro model that he puts on abatement function, that is how much does it cost to abate carbon emissions, and a damage function, how much damage are we gonna get if we let carbon emissions go up? And he calibrates these against some data and you know, gets this prediction of 3.1 degrees. Now that's in part because, despite the fact, it's a bit odd, Nordhaus is an expert on technological change. He does not assume technological change. Now, that's partly because, and maybe, actually, I'll come back to that in a moment. I'll come back to that dichotomy. But so that's one strand of these very simple integrated assessment models are called, that Nordhaus and other, I would say, the very mainstream of the economics establishment uses.
Do they also assume linear damage with temperature?
No, I think the damage functions are nonlinear, but many people think the calibration is just very poor. The damage is a lot more than he estimated. They look at damages by things like looking at how much prices change when, how much do carbon emissions, I can't remember. But so there's another whole strand that's much more engineering driven, much more closely connected to what climate scientists do and what the IPCC does, where they've made big, complicated integrated assessment models that, you know, model the grid and they model deployment of the technologies at some level of detail. They all follow, though, the philosophy of optimality. That is, they try and compute the optimal mixture of technologies through time in order to get the best answer. And I have to say, they've been getting it wrong for a long time. Why? Because they make excessively pessimistic projections about the technology. So here you see the solar energy curve again, and we draw a trend line through it just for reference. And then we put anchor points here for the first predictions that were made back in the year 2000. So you see their prediction going forward, and they see another prediction, various examples of predictions here. All of them are predicting that costs are not going to drop as fast as costs did drop. All of them have predicted deployment will go much slower than it has, despite the fact that those curves that I'm showing you have been around for decades. So they somehow didn't just put the data on log paper and draw the line, and which in the end produced much better forecasts than what they did. In fact, here's a histogram of 2,000, almost 3,000 integrated assessment model projections. And that's another thing. They don't use the word forecast or even conditional forecast. They use a weasel word, projection. Why? Because they want to wave their arms and say, well, we aren't really making a prediction, just a projection. Yeah, okay. So anyway, this is a histogram of these 3,000 projections. This is what actually happened during the decade. These were projections reported in 2014 for the movement between 2010 and 2020. Okay, now back to Jeff's question. One of the things they put in these integrated assessment models, because they don't understand technological change, are floor costs. So they assume for some reason there's going to be some floor cost, and for some reason when we hit that cost, the floor costs are going to flatten out. So we've looked at a lot of data. We have never seen any evidence for floor costs, but they just put them in anyway. And so you can see this is a record of floor costs. These are the actual prices which were repeatedly broken through the floor costs that were assumed in the integrated assessment models. The other restriction they put in are deployment limits. You can only deploy solar energy at such and such a rate, because otherwise their models, because they're optimizing, they'll just slam everything onto solar and then do something that probably is unrealistic, but they haven't been able to figure out how to make the models realistic, because at the end of the day, the models depend on the floor costs and the deployment restrictions, and that clobbers everything else, as well as the assumptions about technological improvement.
By the way, is there data in the early, from the early part of the Industrial Revolution showing any curves like this for coal production or steel production, iron production?
Curves like?
Like the, I mean, the same curves.
Yeah.
Seeing them drop and then
flatten,
so that you see the, what you're calling.
No, so it's possible that there was a period where
that must have happened.
I'm not so sure, Jeff.
Really?
I'm not so sure.
I mean,
because in the early days, you know, you could just pick coal up off the ground.
Sure.
So it's easy to extract. And
well, I mean, once mining became industrial.
Yeah.
And
smelting
of iron and all the rest of that stuff.
So my plot goes back to 1880, which is the earliest date we can get since.
You don't go back to 1810.
No, we can't. We weren't able to do that.
That's too bad.
No.
Okay.
But you know, you can look at other things that started getting mined later, and you look in the USGS database for, you know, molybdenum or something that, you know, I don't think they mined before the data shows up, and it doesn't show any evidence of improvement in the early days. All right, this is just another example. The IEA, which is probably the most influential organization for two decades, has been consistently underestimating progress in solar and all the other renewables. Now, so we made an alternative. Our philosophy, we wanted to just, we weren't trying to compute the optimal thing. We were just trying to show an example of something that was feasible. Because of that, we only used predictable technologies. That is, we only use technologies where we have enough data to make predictions. So we tied our hand behind our back, and we don't use things like, you know, grid sharing and lots of other things that are probably better than what we've got. So we made conservative assumptions. We did not forecast deployment. We just assumed scenarios about deployment, and then we forecast cost given our scenario. I'll show you three representative scenarios. And we don't assume, as all these other models do, we don't assume that we manage to have more efficiency or we manage to use less energy. We assume energy continues to go up. Energy use continues to go up at 2% per year as it has for the last 50 years. And then we make scenarios that can satisfy all the energy requirements for the key, all the sectors of the energy part of the economy. And let me just make a side comment. You know, there are energy is only 4% of GDP. So, and you could argue, I mean, it's about like tourism. But unlike tourism, I mean, during COVID, we pretty much showed it's not fun, but we could do without tourism. Of course, if energy quits, you know, we're just completely screwed. The whole economy grinds to a halt. So it's an example of something that's not very apparent in the kind of data you can get about money flows. So we looked at a fast transition scenario where the key technologies are solar, photovoltaics, wind, batteries, and PTEX fuels. PTEX fuels we use both for the hard to decarbonize sectors like jet fuel, but we also use it for energy store, long-term energy storage. And we made, again, very conservative assumptions. Like for P2X, we assumed that we have enough energy storage so even if the earth goes completely dark for a month, the wind stops blowing completely for a month, we have enough stored hydrogen fuel to run everything as normal for a month. And we, you know, covered sectors like heat, shipping, air transport. And in that way, we phase out fossil fuels entirely in 25 years. And so this shows the three scenarios that we used. We had a fast transition. So that's in this column here. So you see useful energy, final energy, and electricity generation in these panels here. So this is through time. So we're going from 2020 to 2070. And now useful energy is the most important because that's how much work you can actually extract from the energy you've got. We then show the slow transition. This is the kind of thing that's the IEA has been pushing for a long time, Shell, where we go on using natural gas for quite a while. And so we phase things out much more slowly, as you can see here. So eventually solar, which is this orange zone here, comes up. This green is P2X fuels, blue is wind. But you can see here by 2070, we keep some of the stuff like hydropower, but fossil fuels are gone already in 2050. And not true here. There's still a lot of fossil fuels in 2070. And then finally, we have a no transition, business as usual, where, you know, we go on in the crazy mode we've been, where we keep having lots of fossil fuels. And in fact, in the final version of this, we even let some solar and wind come up, but fossil fuels remain substantial. Yeah, Chris?
Just to clarify, so
in these scenarios, is the decrease in fossil fuel use happening by, for instance, legislation or carbon taxes, or is it simply that these other things are cheaper and are outcompeting?
So it's happening by something that we don't specify. We're just saying, let's suppose this happens. What would it cost? And we use models for predicting costs for all the technologies. So for fossil fuels, to go back to maybe my plot back here, I'd have to go all the way back to the beginning. For fossil fuels, you know, fossil fuels haven't changed in price for a century. We use a mean reverting random walk, an AR1 model to predict price of fossil fuels, which is the best model we could find. Actually, that's another thing that James showed. For the improving technologies, we use Wright's Law, the stochastic version of Wright's Law, and we make probabilistic predictions, so we can make probabilistic predictions about future costs of the energy transition.
I guess what I'm asking is that, I mean, there are certain points here where it's simply, there's no economic argument any longer for using coal.
Yeah.
There might be political arguments, of course. And so some of those crossover points are happening pretty soon.
Yeah, no, that's right. And so, but again, these are just scenarios. Just what would happen if it turned out this way? And I can talk about the realism of them a bit more in a minute.
What is not included in this, first of all, what is included is the cost of producing the individual solar panels or the individual, you know, the equipment, the hard.
No, we include all that.
That's
included. We're including LCOE.
We can't. What is not included, presumably, is the whole, whatever energy is going into reconfiguring the entire system.
No, nope. So we included that too.
How is that
now
included?
Now that, I have to say, what we basically did, there we don't have any history for the grid.
Right.
And the grid is the biggest one. You can see that already in this panel, in the fast transition, we assume electricity capacity by 2070 goes up by a factor of 4. So we have 4 times as big a grid as we have now. So you can then, we spend a lot of time going through the data, looking at what does it cost to build a grid. And so we assume there's no improvement. I think there will be some, so we're being conservative again. And there's also questions about, you know, in the US, you can upgrade the grid by just laying more lines in existing troughs without, in many cases, you know, in developing countries, in many cases, you have to lay down whole new lines. So we had to look into all that and make a cost estimate. In the end, that's an important thing, but because we saved so much money by transitioning quickly and driving the cost down, that dominates grid cost. And by the way, we also worried a lot about infrastructure. We're going to replace gas stations by charging stations. Okay, so one of the main things that works for us there is 25 years turns out to be the average lifetime of a gas station. So the infrastructure is getting replaced all the time anyway. We're assuming we replace it at the same rate. We just stop replacing fossil fuel infrastructure and we create new green energy infrastructure. But so we put all that in there. Now, these are just to show you the three scenarios for the key technologies. We assume that solar does this in the three scenarios, like in fossil fuel business as usual scenario, it kind of stops its 40-year trend. It suddenly breaks out of it and does this. These are logarithmic plots again. In the slow transition, it does something like that. And in the fast transition, we're still assuming an S curve. And notice we're really, I mean, we're staying on this curve for a little while, but we're starting the S transition. Why? Because as solar energy starts to become a dominant technology, it can't stay on an exponentially increasing curve for too much longer. And in fact, if you know, if you just extrapolate this curve straight up, we solar and wind take over in less than a decade. It's an exponential change with a 30% improvement rate. So, you know, it goes along seeming insignificant, and then suddenly it becomes huge. And it's the pushback one should immediately make whenever the naysayers say, well, solar is only 3%. Well, wait a few years. So you can see these technologies, you know, the least developed now are what's called green hydrogen or P2X electrolyzers. But even there are things, I don't think we're assuming anything that's implausible. We're just extrapolating the existing trends. Unlike the IEA and all the others, which have been constantly assuming that we were going to break off these trends as we went along. Now, this is showing you our predictions for these things in the future. And now we're contrasting our predictions that we're making now against the predictions our competitors at places like the IEA are making now. And where they are realizing that renewables are improving, and they have their green, have greener scenarios than they did before and more sensible cost, but they're still assuming that they're still getting different answers than we are, as you can see by comparing our probabilistic forecasts in each of these panels with their forecasts or representative examples of their forecasts shown on top of them. You can also see our forecast for oil, coal, and gas here. Now, what is the punchline? Well, here we show between now and 2070, the median expenditures for under the no transition, slow transition, and fast transition. Here we see the discount rates. I mean, as a function of discount rate, what's the median amount we expect to save? And so you see this is the fast transition for the net present value. I'm showing you the wrong plot there. This is an example with a discount rate of 2%. So this is just showing you the distribution of prices. So we're making probabilistic forecasts. We aren't saying this is inevitable. We're just saying it's likely. And here you see the median values as a function of the discount rate. And because there's been a huge debate about the right discount rate to use, depending on the discount rate, it can either cost a fortune to make the green energy transition, or it can be relatively cheap. We instead see that the fast transition, which is this one here, these are trillions of dollars in net present value, is saving us $17.5 trillion relative to no transition, which is shown in black. And it does that at any sensible discount rate. So the discount rate doesn't really matter anymore. It affects the amount of the savings, but we're going to save at any discount rate. And this is what I mean when I say Nordhaus, in our view, got the sign of this wrong. Now, these are emissions, which are, of course, the thing we really care about at the end of the day. And so what we see is that under the fast green transition, you know, by roughly 2050, we're down to negligible emissions. This is the slow transition. This is business as usual. So we've also done a lot of work with Rupert Way and Francois Lafond and Fabrizio Lillo, who was a postdoc here, on technology investment portfolios, where, you know, in a traditional investment portfolio, like you learn about when you take a finance course, they assume that the investments have no effect on the things that are being invested in. And instead we said, well, suppose the things you're investing in follow Wright's law. How does that change things? Makes the problem incredibly nonlinear. And it also changes the whole conclusion you come to, because from a standard advice you get taking finance 101 in a business school, they would say that you should always diversify. But if you're dealing with Wright's law, you don't make progress down the curve unless you invest in it. So you, rather than investing in everything as you would under standard finance, you don't want to put all your eggs in one basket because you don't have certainty about which things are likely, investments are likely to pay off. But you don't want to spread all your eggs across lots of baskets. You want to pick a few baskets, you know, four or five or six, put your eggs in those baskets, and that will produce the best results. Now, so far I've been talking about time series analysis as the basis for this. But you know, you can say, well, how do you know that's going to be true? How do you know it's going to keep going? Well, I'd say we don't, but we're better than the competition because at least we have empirical evidence with, you know, zillions of p-values of statistical significance that it's very likely that those things will follow their trends. But there are times where they don't. For example, with Moore's law, we're getting close to hitting a wall where we know that quantum mechanics is going to cause a truncation point. So we're also working on doing this kind of thing from first principles and working on modeling all the economics around it from first principles. So this is a chart that was made by my ex-graduate student, Penny Mealy, that sort of represents different things in our group at Oxford and some of our collaborators are doing, where we're really trying to understand the production network, households, the laborers who work in the production network, the energy system, like the work I've done here. We have models for innovation and technological change that are based not just on time series, but on patent analysis, green industrial strategies that are very much based around the kind of thing that Ricardo Hausmann does, as well as we're teaming up with people who do agriculture and land use and teaming up with political scientists who can help us think about what the political implications of this are and how do we adopt strategies to get maximum adoption. And just to finish the talk, well, let me think. So yeah, I think this is a sensitive intervention point that is, all we have to do is keep the existing trends going for one more decade and we've dealt with 75% of climate change. What do we have to do to make sure that happens? We have to make sure the grid gets built everywhere it needs to be built. My son, Miles Farmer, works for the Federal Energy Regulation Commission. He says that they have enough proposed green projects for renewables to more than double the electrical capacity of the United States. What's blocking approval is grid capacity. And it's very political to get grid capacity expanded because there's a lot of forces that resist it. So there are some bottlenecks, but those roadblocks are relatively small. And that is, it doesn't take much technologically, it's relatively cheap. And by the way, here's what I put in the number. We estimate that expanding the grid to four times capacity is about a $500 billion task, but we're gonna save we spend about $4 trillion a year on energy costs. So if energy prices go down by half, as we expect they eventually will, the savings over here outweigh that. Yeah.
I think about expanding the grid, it just seems to me that you're being very optimistic. I actually spoke about this with Dan Schrag,
who
tells me the numbers of like how it's expanding now, and it's like infinitesimal compared to the rate that it needs. And I've seen a number of grid lines that have been proposed for 10 years that get nixed by some, you know, NIMBYism going on.
So I'm not saying it's not a big political problem. I'm just saying it's technologically, it's not a hard problem. Cost-wise, it's not a big problem. It's a political problem.
Yeah, I agree.
It's a political problem, and it's an important one. We are lucky in that the U.S. actually has more grid capacity than it needs. So the U.S. can expand for a while without expanding the grid. But in other places, that's not true. So my last slide, personal note, I sailed from Sardinia to Tangier along the African coast. So through two major petrostates, this is a picture I took of coal getting loaded into a ship in Morocco. I actually, I saw lots of oil tankers and so on. These petrostates are going to collapse in the next 25 years. So we're gonna have a big geopolitical problem because the basis of many economies is going to go down the tube. So we really, the green energy transition, well, it's only 4% of GDP. It's a big deal for the economy. It's quite feasible. timescales are there. We need to remove some of the political roadblocks. We're going to face a lot of transition risk. I think it's actually bigger than physical climate risk from making that transition. And so on that note, I'd like to end. Thank you. Carlos?
Yeah. From the first part of your talk where you speak about technological innovation, I mean, many people use the analogy of describing technological evolution as a type of biological evolution, but I wonder whether you could do the opposite, since whether the types of innovation that sometimes the price increases or decreases rapidly or stagnates, could you draw comparisons to biological evolution?
Yeah. So it's interesting. I have a paper with Ricardo Soleil, and there's also a nice paper by Andreas Wagner discussing these analogies, and I think they're rich. There are important differences. Now, one of the differences, and this may be just a difference in data, in technology, we can measure technological performance through time. It happens on time scales we can track. Where, as it's very hard to know, you know, how fast could dinosaurs run, and you know, how efficient were their lungs and stuff like that. Some wild estimates can be made. So, and what we care about is a bit different, because with technology, we care about, you know, how good are the engineering solutions going to be through time. These scaling laws have been shown, particularly by Chris McGee at MIT, to exist not just for cost, but for performance measures like how much energy can you store in a kilogram of matter or in a liter of volume? And how strong can you make a material? So we have these performance metrics. We've seen consistent long-term scaling on the order of a century or more. Now, there's of course many other important differences between biological evolution and technological evolution. Genetics is a big one. And so that means the nature of the change is somewhat different, but I think broadly speaking, the same kind of analogies apply. And I could, you know, spend a whole hour talking about that question. So I should probably not say too much more. Michael?
I have lots of questions, but I'll start.
Could you take your mask off?
Sorry. I have lots of questions, but I'll start just, and this was an amazing talk. But so my impression was that there are some countries that really invested a lot in solar and wind, like Germany and China. Whereas in your talk, it seemed, well, it just happened on its own. So yeah. Is the investment there important? Did the investment drive it simply through use? Or what did the investment do?
Yeah.
Do we need to do more?
Yeah, so those investments were very important. I don't mean to say that it would just happen on its own. Some of it happened on its own. It's not clear how different it would have been. And the way something happens on its own, you know, I mentioned the first use was in the Vanguard satellite. Cost didn't matter. Then people said, well, okay, we're gonna put a weather station at the South Pole. Let's use solar photovoltaics because they're reliable. And so there are niche applications. And as the cost comes down, the size of those niche applications goes up. And those are the things that create the cycle, that the cause and effect relationships that causes the price to come down. Now, Nordhaus, back to a question earlier, Nordhaus, the reason he didn't put in technological change is because he said, well, how do we know whether costs drive production up? Because after all, if costs go down for whatever reason, we expect demand will go up. And so maybe it's just the costs are going down, and that's just the causality is backwards from what we're assuming here, or vice versa. So with Francois Lafond, and we collected data from World War II, and we collected data on military technologies. Why? Because in World War II, there are numerous statements by Roosevelt saying, I don't care how much it costs, we're gonna build this at all, by all means. And US went from the 18th largest military in the world to producing 2/3 of the military equipment for both sides combined. And we produced a lot of the Russian tanks. And so there's a gigantic ramp up and then a ramp down. So better data set in some respects than the one Bela collected. And where we could asked the causality question. And what we saw there was sort of 50-50. 50% was an overall trend. Prices just came down during World War II. And the other 50 was that things we made more of, the costs came down more than things we didn't make very much of. So we, when we showed that to Nordhaus, he said, oh, well, the glass is half empty, because I told you there was going to be some other effect going on there. But we said it's half full. That's all we need. And so there's clearly causality flowing from production to cost. In places like Germany, with the Eigenwende, they did a lot to boost that. You also see, by the way, that places like Denmark, that were early adopters of wind energy, also became leaders in the production of those technologies. And so one of the key reframings we're making with this paper, and it's really key that we're not just saying it's cheap, we're saying it's profitable, and is that it's now an opportunity. It's not a cost to be borne. It's an opportunity to make money. And the countries and businesses that get on that wagon quickly will be the ones that will make that money. Chris?
This is a larger discussion, but I'm curious first whether you've gotten any constructive reply from IEA from graphs showing that over and over again they were wrong, always in the same direction. But I'm also curious, this may be biased by the local political climate, but there are a lot of environmental organizations that I'm really starting to feel are being increasingly counterproductive by holding on to a 50-year-old culture within the environmental movement of no, use less, build less. Yeah. It's all about less. And that's not what we need actually now. And I think a lot of environmentalists are honestly confused by this, and they hear, first of all, you can make money doing this. And they're like, oh, but I thought making money was bad. And I would put my own 10-year past self in that category. And then also, you're talking about building more power lines and stuff, but we want to, preserve the scenery and preserve local jurisdiction. And I'm kind of hoping that Manchin's compromise over streamlining permitting of power of pipelines will turn into streamlining permitting of power lines as well. I have no idea if that will happen. So I'm just wondering whether you've had engagement.
Yeah, sure. So we had a hell of a time getting this paper published. We've been working to get it published now for 2 years. Maybe that's a little bit our fault for being slow at times, but the establishment fought like hell, because there's a big establishment of integrated assessment modelers who are the main contributors to the IPCC reports, and they really didn't want this published because it makes them look bad. And actually, in the initial version, we didn't have the picture, we didn't have the actual data comparing, just really dramatically showing how bad they've done, but they still criticize it for other things. And we realized we had to actually put that in. So we've got a lot of resistance, but thankfully it's going to be published in Joule beginning of September. And this is one paper where I'm going to be unabashed about going for publicity, because I really think it changes the dialogue on climate change. Eric Meinhacker claims that our paper actually had a big effect on the Manchin compromise and was part of what brought Manchin around. I'm hoping he can document that. But to your second question, I completely agree. I mean, absent this news, I would be with those green people saying, let's use less, let's do all that. But for energy, once we have renewable energy, it's cheap, it's clean, the environmental impacts are fairly minimal from solar and wind. They aren't zero, but they're pretty low. And there are a lot of positive effects for cheap energy, and particular for developing countries. It's going to be huge. We don't really need more energy, but they do. And so I do think we have to retool. I think this does retool the thinking. Natalie?
So thanks. First of all, it is nice and hopeful to see all this. But I am going to be one of those old environmentalists. Mm-hmm. Because the problem is, yes, many technologies would be beneficial, but often technologies have unintended consequences. And the investment that we give in some technologies mean that we're not looking elsewhere. And so if you look at the big picture and you see, okay, well, maybe it's fine to have more photovoltaics and all that, But if it does mean that, okay, well, now we can like we can continue as we are, we can lay back, and technology will solve our problem, it's a huge opportunity not to have actually improve in many other ways our ways of life. So for, I mean, there's plenty of evidence of an unintended consequences that are not considered, but also there's lock-ins into systems that can be generated. And I think there's a point in those old-fashioned environmentalists that actually, if we rethink the way we live, we can get so much more out of it than simply reducing energy in this case.
No. So to me, it depends on which thing you're asking. If you are you seriously interested in dealing with climate change? I don't think changing our lifestyle is going to dent climate change seriously. So if we really care about climate change, I think we have to go with the technological fix. On the other hand, I agree with you strongly about sustainability. We need a sustainable economy. And you know, things there's interesting scaling laws, like, you know, the amount of mass we use per dollar of GDP goes down at about 0.7% per year. That's hopeful for sustainability in general. If GDP weren't going up at 2% per year, those things might balance, and then we would get, there'd be what, at least one indicator of sustainability. We now need to look not just at energy, but at lots of other things like agriculture. Agriculture is the big demon in my view, or will be in the future, because agriculture is the biggest enemy of biodiversity by far. It's the thing that's sucking the planet dry so that only people exist and animals and plants exist in a highly biodegraded state. So I think that's really the key thing we need to change, and we need to make the economy fully sustainable. Now, I don't think we're going to do that because we run out of material. Over and over again, you know, material shortages, we either find more of the material or we find another material that works just as well or better. And so the history of technological change makes that really clear. But I completely agree. I want to have a soft environmental impact on the planet. I'd like to see a planet with a tenth as many people with a much smaller environmental footprint and living in, you know, parkland punctuated by beautiful cities. And I'm all for that. And I want to do everything I can to make that happen. But I want to be realistic about it and not advocate pipe dreams that just aren't going to happen. Melanie?
So if the goal is to increase the grid by a factor of four, sort of how much space is there in like modernization of the grid? You know, the grid is an ancient thing. It seems like that could be a direction that might get over some of these political obstacles.
Yeah. So like in the US, as I said, we think a lot of it can be done by just taking existing grid infrastructure and putting more wires in conduits that already exist. Some new wires will need to be laid, of course, because if you're going to put a solar farm out in the middle of the desert somewhere, you're going to have to get the power over there. And though we didn't assume any, we assumed a very localized energy system with no more back and forth long range transmission than we have now. Long range transmission is probably a much cheaper solution. So we will probably be building trunk lines across the US. You know, those can be buried. That's a little more costly than putting them up in the sky. But it can all be done in a way that's, you know, in the end, I don't think these costs are huge. And there's a lot of devils in the details that I don't understand. But I don't think it's insurmountable at all. Sam?
Thanks for a wonderful talk, Doyne. In thinking about the various scenarios that you put forward, I think a lot about what happens if the rest of the world comes to have a standard of living of, say, poor people in Denmark.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be fantastic.
Yeah.
And that would mean probably that the world would have to produce something like four times the amount that's now being produced.
Of stuff,
yeah. I mean, a lot more.
Yeah, yeah.
And that is, like sustainability, a really strong moral imperative.
Yeah.
Something like that ought to happen if it can possibly happen. But that's probably not part of the scenario you showed.
Well, so we're just focusing on energy here.
Yeah.
So we think the energy part of that is quite doable, because that 2% per year increase, significant amount of that is coming from the developing world and not just, you know, I mean, you probably know better than I, Jeff, but I think over the last few decades, energy consumption per capita in the US is fairly flat. So the growth is coming from where we want it, which is the extreme poor. But we need to do, so I think we can solve energy, but we need to think it through with the whole economy. And we really need to make environmental analysis an essential part of every economic thing that we do. And I think it's quite achievable to produce four times as much stuff, produce it in a much more lightweight way. You know, it's also worth remembering that what is GDP? I mean, GDP is whatever it is that we're making. If that stuff gets lighter and smaller and, you know, has a smaller environmental footprint, GDP can still go up. So I don't think we have to have a no growth world. We just have a different kind of growth. It's a more elegant growth. And we're already seeing that to a significant extent. You know, I want to say a little bit more about your comment because I really agreed with what you were saying almost entirely. You know, I'm a bit of a technophobe myself. I was glad to read that Jules Verne himself was a technophobe. I hate my iPhone. I hate that damn thing. You know, but I'm forced to use it because I have to. And technology giveth and technology taketh away. You know, it makes our lives better in some way. We get automobiles, we can get from A to B fast, but now we have these loud things that run over our children and pollute and, you know, are a pain in the neck. So we have to each technology has its side effects. We need to keep working to get technology with lower side effects. You know, we put cars on the road, we got rid of horseshit. And, you know, we're going to at least make the cars electric so they'll be quieter and more energy efficient, you know. And with solar, we're really replacing a very dirty technology with a very clean technology with minimal side effects. So, but we're always going to be stuck in that loop and we're always going to be slaves to our technology. You know, Kevin Kelly and others joke that actually is technology for us or are we for technology? Jim?
Just a simple, one brief question. How many concrete models do we have of sustainable systems? And Sam, Jeff, maybe Doyne, you can comment. If you know, what's your experience? How many?
Yeah.
You folks are working really hard, and this issue keeps coming up.
Yeah.
How many proof of principle sustainable systems, or even just models, do we have? No,
yeah.
They are sustainable.
There's Robinson Crusoe.
Nice. Okay. Start.
But
where's that island?
Yeah.
Sustainable ecologically. You don't mean.
I mean sustainable in whatever sense we've been talking about here. I mean in terms of well-being and health and the economy and technology.
Yeah.
I just have a question.
I mean, I think we're still stumbling along. I think we can model little bits of it. Like go back to the picture I showed a few slides back. We're actually looking at how the production network will be rewired to make the green energy system. So not just thinking about solar cells, but what are their inputs? And how does the whole production network rewire? How much rewiring does it take? And then going down and looking at the labor transition, how many new occupations, how many people have to change occupation to make that happen? How feasible is that to do at the timescale at which occupational transitions naturally happen? Because we have a model for the diffusion of occupational transitions. And so we can then, we're doing a little piece of sustainability because we're now actually, we're not just projecting the trend. We're saying, this is a roadmap for how it will happen, what the new production network will look like in 30 years, what the new labor landscape will look like, and how much retraining do we need to do to get there? Or do we even need to do retraining? Or do we have to worry about that gating the transition or not? So we can answer all those questions. And so we're chipping away at it. But yeah, it'd be really nice to do that for the whole economy and really say, here's the sustainable economy we want to get to in 50 years. And here's a roadmap to get there. And, you know, I'd love to do that before I die. Oh, one more?
Just a quick comment.
Chris, could you take your mask off?
Really interesting debate. I mean, I think that a lot of environmentalists are sort of hoping that the only way to solve climate change is to make the world much more democratic, much more decentralized, much more fair in all the social ways we want, and, you know, get rid of capitalism or whatever. This is sort of the Kim Stanley Robinson model, right? Mm-hmm. That, you know, we'll all die unless we greatly improve our social and economic and, you know, extend the force of law to non-human animals and all this wonderful stuff, which is all, a lot of that's very desirable. But maybe the best way to justify those struggles is not climate change. It's sort of like, you know, I guess Dan Schrag put some friend of his saying, but Dan, oh, why don't we just eat, you know, more local food? Won't that solve the problem? It's like, you know, no. I mean, eating food from local organic farmers is a great idea for lots of reasons, not particularly for climate.
Yeah.
So I don't know. When I talk to environmentalists about the sort of thing that you're presenting, a lot of them are visibly disappointed. It's like, you mean we can do this without making the world fairer and more equal? It's like, well, yeah. So on to the next problem, right? And so,
yeah.
Maybe this particular exercise is not the right driver.
I do think, maybe a corollary, I mean, I do think the Green New Deal was a pretty darn good idea that could have combined. I mean, you have to work out the details, but there's some version of the Green New Deal that I think our model is saying would really work, because that's essentially what we're advocating, by the way, is I think the timescale of the Biden policy is actually a little slower than what we're showing here. We think this is just the ride that's going to happen if you just remove the blocks. And, you know, what we should be doing is a Green New Deal. We're really funding a wholehearted, let's do this as fast as we can. It will have lots of other positive side effects. Just to list them, you know, less pollution, jobs, energy security. We get all kinds of less energy volatility. Fossil fuels are flat over the long run, but the prices are hugely volatile, as are the prices of everything that gets mined out of the ground. Another fact. Whereas solar, wind, very flat prices. That means you can really plan much better. So it means we don't have the same bumps in the road. You know, we have had energy-driven recessions. And so, so there's all kinds of side benefits. And so I think we should embrace those. It would be nice if we could somehow get the political landscape to change too. But I don't know that all that stress would have taken it for the better.
Yeah, just, I mean, I agree that the climate change is not the only thing. And I think that's my point, is if we're looking at only solving climate change, fantastic, this is wonderful news.
Yeah.
But we're not, I mean, there are other things that
there are plenty of other things to solve.
And if we decide, okay, well, we're all fine now because we have this cheap and clean energy, then let's invest in electric vehicles, as you just said. I don't think that's the right solution, because that will solve some of the climate change problem. It will solve some of the air pollution problem, but only some. It will create problems for people who produce the batteries, who mine the cobalt and the Congo.
Yeah.
And it will mean that we're invested into a system where we're actually don't have any incentives to create another kind of city where actually we could live much, much more healthily. Mm-hmm. And happily. So that's, I mean, it's not that it's not the a right solution for climate change, but we need to be thinking about other things. And when we think about holistically, as you do right there, and when we think in systems, I think we should be thinking a lot more than just tackling climate change.
No.
That's exactly
no, I totally agree.
We're right, totally on the same page.
But the question is, would you be willing to try to solve other problems at the cost of not solving climate change and climate bang?
No, I think we can do this together. That's what I'm saying. It doesn't have to be one or the other.
I mean, it's also, you know, the powers and the jobs in the solar industry of installers and so on are really a lot less well-paying. They're not unionized, and they're a lot less well-paying than the few remaining jobs in fossil fuel. And that's one of the reasons why solar is getting so cheap, because now a majority of it is not the hardware, but the labor. And there is a real tension there that we have to acknowledge, that
The good news is we think there are more jobs. So it's a net increase in jobs, but they are lower paying jobs.
Right.
Thank you very much.